Our next session is a writer's odyssey, Muneeza Shamsie in conversation with Amit Chaudhuri. Amit Chaudhuri is the author of 7 novels, the latest of which is Friend of My Youth. He is also a poet, essayist, musician, and composer. He is a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature. In 2013, he was awarded the first Infosys Prize in the Humanities for outstanding contribution to literary studies. Amit?
Yeah.
Over to you, Muneeza. Thank you.
Hello. I'm sorry for the confusion and delay. If anyone wanted to come to the partition session, that's actually downstairs in the Jasmine room. We are having an in-conversation with Amit Chaudhuri. Okay. Well, it gives me great pleasure to... Can I take this out? It's easier for me to read. Hello. Yes. It gives me great pleasure to be here today, to be in conversation with Amit Chaudhuri, who is both a distinguished writer and also an accomplished musician and composer. And many of you would have heard his performance yesterday evening. He was, I'm going to go over some of the details that you just heard, but he was born in Calcutta and grew up in Bombay, where his father was a company executive, and Amit learned to love music from his mother, a gifted singer of Bengali songs and devotionals. Amit went to the Cathedral School and Connon School in Mumbai, graduated in English literature from the University College London, did his doctorate at Balliol College, Oxford, and has held many distinguished academic appointments. He is now Professor of Contemporary Literature at the University of East Anglia, and he is also a Fellow of the Royal Society of Literature and the recipient of many literary awards, including the Indian Government's Sahitya Academy Award and the first Infosys Prize in the Humanities for Outstanding Contribution to Literature. His academic writings include a collection of critical essays, writings on D.H. Lawrence and Tagore, and 2 anthologies, The Picador Book of Modern Indian Literature and Memory's Gold, Writings on Calcutta. He has also published 2 books of nonfiction, a story collection, a poetry collection, and several award-winning novels. Interestingly, music permeates much of his fiction, but his use of language has a musicality that begins with his very first novel, A Strange and Sublime Address, which was published in 1991 and tells of a Bombay-based boy's visit to his extended family in Calcutta. It is filled with wondrous images which embody much of Amit Chaudhuri's writing. His second novel won the Betty Trask Award, a Commonwealth Writers Award for the Best First Novel, and was shortlisted for the Guardian Fiction Award, and was then republished in a 25th anniversary edition, by which time Amit Chaudhuri was regarded as one of the leading writers of Anglophone fiction today. The book is considered the first in the trilogy, of which the second novel, Afternoon Rag, employs the moods of the rag to capture the emotions of his protagonists, an Indian undergraduate at Oxford, and it won the Encore Award and the Southern Arts Literature Prize, while the trilogy's third novel, Freedom Song, is set in Calcutta against the backdrop of the Babri Masjid conflict. Chaudhuri's work is remarkable for the fact that he started writing in an era where other Indian English writers were trying to capture the Indian sound by employing a hybrid bizarre English and a fast-moving, rambunctious narrative. He kept his prose very, very quiet, very contained, and where the protagonist's occupation with mundane daily events belie complex, quietly simmering emotions. His fifth novel, The Immortals, which was shortlisted for the Commonwealth Writers Award and the DSC Award, revolves around music and musicians. and a company executive's wife and a gifted singer cannot give expression to her talent due to family commitments, while her idealistic son, an aspiring musician, finds himself alienated from the lifestyle of his parents. Themes of belonging, home and homeland also run through much of Amit Chaudhuri's work. In Odyssey as Abroad, he provides an intertextual engagement with and a reinterpretation of Homer's Odyssey to tell of a young Indian student and his uncle both living in London. His new novel, Friend of My Youth, takes this a step further by merging autobiography and fiction to tell of the UK-based Indian-born writer called Amit Chaudhuri, author of The Immortals and Afternoon Rag, who returns for a book event to Mumbai, where he grew up, and where his impressions of the present are intertwined with memories of the past, and particularly Ramu, his only surviving school friend, who is a drug addict and in rehab. The novel, which has been described as a Minna masterpiece in the British press and acclaimed by an Indian reviewer as a book which maps mind and memory, provides a very moving and incisive insight into the relationship between an expatriate and his erstwhile homeland. And I have to say that the descriptions of change that he captures, the flyovers, the high rises, the disappearing old buildings, the expansion of the city and daily violence, has clear echoes with Karachi and doubtless many other burgeoning cities in our troubled and changing world. I'm now going to ask him to read an extract from Friend of My Youth.
Okay, so thank you, Muneeza, for your introduction. Lovely.
Thank you.
Very generous. And I'm going to read the first few pages of Friend of My Youth. Muneeza has already described what it's about, so I won't give you a background, but it's set over, it's a very short novel. The first two-thirds is set over a couple of days when he comes, when Amit Chaudhuri, I sort of say the name hesitantly, but when he arrives in Bombay and you know, he's about to read from The Immortals. And then the second and third parts are very short, and they are about other visits to the city when this drug addict friend who was in a punitive rehab where he could not access the outside world has come back, has returned to Bombay. There are many reasons for having written this book, and I will discuss them no doubt with Muneeza, but one of them had to do with the unsettlement of being able to access this friend, this one childhood friend, remaining childhood friend in Bombay, and the unexpected nature of the unsettlement, because one didn't expect to be disoriented in the way that I was, that this man is, by the friend's absence. So the friend's absence has an unexpectedly disorienting impact on this man who's in Bombay. The other thing I have to say is that it's a Bombay in which Amit Chaudhuri grew up, but in which he no longer has a home. His parents moved away from Bombay, and so he stays in hotel rooms or clubs. That's the other source of disorientation. I'm beginning, the novel begins with a quote from Walter Benjamin's One-Way Street. I thought I should point that out in case you compliment me for the opening paragraph. The opening paragraph is not an epigraph, so I don't say anywhere that this is Walter Benjamin. It's woven into the text, but it's within quotation marks. We have long forgotten the ritual by which the house of our life was erected. But when it is under assault and enemy bombs are already taking their toll, what enervated, perverse antiquities do they not lay bare in the foundations? I must interrupt myself and say that there's a third disorienting factor, and this is the memory of the 26/11 attacks in Bombay are still fresh at this time in early 2011. So this man will visit the Taj with a couple of shoes, with a pair of shoes to exchange for his mother. And the Taj is more or less in pristine condition again, but he knows that this continuity is an illusion. What things were interred and sacrificed amid magic incantations? What horrible cabinet of curiosities lies there below, where the deepest shafts are reserved for what is most commonplace? In a night of despair, I dreamed I was with my first friend from my school days, whom I had not seen for decades and had scarcely ever remembered in that time, tempestuously renewing our friendship and brotherhood. But when I awoke, it became clear that what despair had brought to light like a detonation was the corpse of that boy, who had been immured as a warning that whoever one day lives here may in no respect resemble him. I think of Ramu when I read these lines. It's of him I think when I reread them. I have no idea why. For one thing, Ramu isn't my first friend from my school days, though he's the only surviving school friend I'll see when I visit Bombay. Bombay, the city I grew up in. The city I grew up in but knew very little. That is, a pretty limited number of roads, specific clusters of buildings. I feel a deep sadness reading these lines. I can't say why. When I arrive into Bombay, I make phone calls. This is in the taxi or the car that's come to receive me from the airport and reach me to wherever it is I'm staying, club or hotel. All the while I'm registering the unfamiliar, the new flyovers, the disappearance of certain things which weren't quite landmarks but which helped you orient yourself, furniture showrooms, fisherfolk's settlements. I would be surprised, maybe even disappointed, if these large-scale changes did not occur. On the right-hand side, at the end of the road from the airport towards Mahim, is, I know, the mosque with loudspeakers, hemmed in by traffic. On the left, further up, past the brief stink of the sea, will be the church where I once went to attend an NA meeting. I was keeping Ramu company. These aren't paths in which I grew up, but my childhood is coming back to me, the terror, the bewilderment and impatience, the contempt for others, for the city, the magical sense of superiority, like an armor, nurtured inadvertently by your parents, hard to regain. This is a new route. It's very grandiose. A bridge suspended over water. I've been on it twice before. It is still. In the monsoons, its cables look immovable against the sheets of rain. Suddenly, there's an island, low and humped with irregular houses and a temple, which you never saw on the old route. That route's roughly parallel to this one, which is seaborne. Fisherfolk, no slum. The original islanders, you can't but romanticize them when granted such a glimpse. They were invisible for perhaps more than a century from the Mahim side. Maybe they preferred it that way. Maybe they never realized they were invisible. Maybe they don't know they're visible. Of course, they'd have noticed the bridge come up over the years. Children would have grown up and left in the time. Do they leave? It doesn't look like a place to go away from. The houses have a light wash, pale yellow or pink or white. The bridge doesn't last long. It's meant to cut the duration of the journey. When you're on it, you want it. The straight lines, the geometry, the inviolable sterility to last longer. There are no pedestrians. Everything you claim to miss, human noise, congestion, you cease to miss when you're on the bridge. Death in life. The other end dumps the cars into Worli, the wrong side of Worli. The car needs to make a U-turn round the potholes. In place of the old sea-facing bungalows, the high buildings for the new rich flank the left. The sea on the right is desolate, though it isn't by the Marine Drive or before the Gateway or even in Juhu. Your first taste of the sea, contained, menacing. Contrary to your desires, you've been deposited in the middle of nowhere, which is what Worli was and is. Still, the signal has come back. You can make calls again. I think I'll stop there. Is it okay?
Okay, that's fine. Yes, thank you very much. That's a lovely sort of introduction to the book. And I think actually I'm going to begin with the title. You said the title was from an Alice Munro story, and you fell in love with the title long before the book developed because it implied possibility. So can you sort of develop on that, on this idea of possibility, and then of course how that related to the book and how that became a part of it?
Okay. I think I've described the kind of three impulses behind the book.
Yes.
The friend's absence. Staying in a club room, looking out on the building in which I grew up, in Malabar Hill. What it means to be in those rooms in a city you've grown up in. The visit to the Taj, the illusion of continuity, the destruction and the resurrection, and the disjunct between the two. The paragraph from Walter Benjamin, the dream about the friend, the intuition of destruction. The other thing is, and this is something that has preoccupied me in one way or another, right from the beginning, writing itself. What does it mean to write? What are you doing? What kind of world is it bringing into existence? Is it bringing a world into existence? When do we start writing? And so again and again, I've begun to feel that the moment of writing begins at a certain point. But it is not to do with when you set down a word on paper. It's not to do with an idea. So the convergence between writing as a form, convergence between living, what we call living, and writing as a form of living as a form of this moment when this creative action begins, which we call writing. This is something I've been interested right from the beginning of when I began to write. I was always interested in this act of writing itself, which was doing something, which was a form of action, rather than necessarily action in the conventional sense we understand that word. Writing can begin at various points. You might be walking down a road and something happens, or you might be looking at a picture and something happens, or you might think of an image, something happens, and you are in a different domain, and that domain can only be called that domain of writing, which is also a form of living. So writing not as a form of telling, but as a form of living. To clarify further on that point, Jean-Paul Sartre describes an adventure as something that has happened, that can be recounted. He says, we can't know that we are in an adventure. We don't think I'm in an adventure. That's disputable, but generally true. We don't know we are in an adventure. An adventure only becomes an adventure on the recounting. This is what happened. So he makes a distinction there between, he says it very clearly, between living, between life, and between our addiction to telling. And what he says about the adventure is also true about history, that I don't think we can really know that we are in history. We don't feel that I'm in a historical moment. History becomes history on the recounting, on the telling. Again, history depends on our addiction to telling. Otherwise, history, as we live it, like everything we live through, has that open-ended, undecided, lifelike quality, where it is difficult to tell the difference between what's important and what's unimportant, which those distinctions are made in the recounting, in the telling, when we become aware, this is history, this is an adventure. Between the two, it's the lifelike, open-ended quality of experience and meaning that I am interested in and identify with writing rather than the business of telling. I'm less interested in telling than in living, and in writing as living, as that open-ended thing. The moment of writing can begin at any point where the imagination converges with the moment you're in. It can begin, as I said, while walking down the street. It can begin while looking at the jacket of a book that you like. The jacket of a book, you look at the book. There are many books we buy but don't read. Often we buy them because we like the jacket. This is because the writer in us has taken over. We are imagining what the book is by looking at the jacket. This is the moment of writing as well. The moment of writing can also come when you encounter a title you like. Again, it is not always necessary to read the book, because we are readers, but we are all also writers. And some of us encounter a title, we love the title, we never read the book. We have constructed our own sense of what that title means. For me, Friend of My Youth by Alice Munro was such a title, in which it was one of the moments in which writing began many, many years ago, that this is an extraordinary title, I like it for some reason. And that for some reason hints at the imagination of the writer taking over and superseding the reader. So the reader doesn't progress, doesn't actually think, Friend of My Youth, now I'm going to read page one, page two, page three, and finish the story. The moment of writing has begun, the imagination is then thinking of something that the title has given to you. Then you wait. You never know if you lacked upon it, but in my case I did. The book then came into being for which that title was the only title, and it had given me that sort of moment many years prior to me writing this book.
Thank you. That's really interesting. It's a bit consoling to me to have, because I've got a row of books, you see, that are unread, and I think, oh gosh, I must read these books. Not that I'm a writer and I'm going to do, but that's a very interesting answer. One of the things that really interests me is your treatment of violence in Friend of My Youth, and the other one that I know is a Freedom Song, which is set at the background of the Babri Masjid. The violence is there, but there's never any polemic, there's never any kind of sort of, you know, it's just built into the narrative and it just sort of moves on, you know. It touches the emotions rather than a kind of polemical passion, so to speak. Can you comment on that?
Sure. Well, two things. The first has to do with my dislike of of centrality and of exhibiting and showcasing things that are supposed to be central or important to the book or to our idea of what's important. So it could be violence or, as I was saying to you earlier today, in Freedom Song, the young man Bhaskar, who is a member of the Communist Party in Calcutta, is preparing for a street play. He's preparing to act in a street play, which for the first third of the book is all that's being talked about by him and his friends. But actually the play is never shown. Over here in this book, it's not just the violence. This man has come to do a reading from the immortals.
Yes.
But I never actually describe the reading. It's the first two-thirds of the book is about him in that state of unsettlement or disorientation, wandering through the city, going to certain places, remembering certain things, and also aware that he has to do a reading from the immortals. But the reading is actually never shown. Yes. And this comes from some kind of prejudice against giving what's supposed to be central, what should be shown, centrality. And that, I think, also has to do with... So it's not just violence. I don't like to give anything centrality in my book, in my books. It partly has to do, I think, with my prejudice against the legacy of the European Renaissance, which has a kind of which has a sense of the protagonist, of the main figure in the painting, and has a clear sense that other figures are secondary, and that what surrounds the figure is a setting for the figure, and that Renaissance view is also coterminous with the emergence of humanism, which is the human being at the center of the universe, and that it's the human being's story. And that brings with it ideas of that the story has something central, a central figure in it, and other things play a part around the figure in as much as they're relevant to that central figure. This model to me is not so interesting. It's oppressive, in fact, to me. So I want to unshackle myself from this model in which the protagonist is there as in a photographer's studio, and then you have the backdrop. For me, everything is important.
Well, I was interested that you referred to the immortals. In many ways, of course, this friend of my youth reflects themes that emerge in your novels, the Bombay childhood, the links with Calcutta, mother who loves singing. But there are specific references to the immortal, which actually took you longer than any of the other novels, I believe. Can you tell us more about it?
About the immortals?
Yes.
And why it took so long to write?
Yes.
Yeah. So I published my fourth novel, A New World, in 2000, and I published The Immortals in 2009. There's more than one reason as to why it took me 9 years to on paper write my fifth novel. One of them had to do with the practical thing first. I thought I was going to write a non-fiction book about Indian classical music, and then got distracted by this image coming to me again and again of a young man from a privileged background who, like many young men, likes to pretend he's poor, that is, he wears torn kurtas and kolhapuri chappals, and is ill at ease in his world of privilege, drawn to Hindustani classical music and a particular teacher, who is a great teacher, who is trying to make his peace with, not only peace with, trying to flourish in a world through his dependence on this corporate world and the corporate wives that he teaches. And the young man with his romantic ideas of what an artist should be cannot understand this older man's comfortableness with this world he feels so uncomfortable with. So I kept seeing this young man in the torn kurta and the older man with his hair oiled back, each puzzling over the other. The older man thinking that this is such a privileged young man, he's so lucky. Why is he always unhappy? Why does he seem grumpy? And the younger man unable to understand how an artist can be comfortable in this particular world. And I got transfixed by the tragicomic nature of their misunderstanding. So having embarked upon or thought of embarking upon a non-fiction book about Indian music and music in general, I found myself sidetracked by this image and found it necessary to investigate what lay beyond that image. That was one reason. The other one was what I can only call deprofessionalizing myself as a novelist. By the end of the 90s, by 1999, I returned to India in 1999. By that time, the free market. So in 1989, the Berlin Wall had collapsed. And then we emerged into this more or less unipolar, free market driven economy and world. There were no choices, there were no alternatives anymore. There were kind of illusions of alternatives, but there weren't any actually. And I was in England at the time, and I was getting tired of the increasing homogenization. All the publishers had become homogenized. They had their earlier names, their different names, like Jonathan Cape, William Heinemann, Secker and Warburg, but they'd all been bought over by about three or four German companies. So, you might go from Secker and Warburg to Cape, or to some other publisher, but it was more or less the same. Just as the Labour Party, New Labour, had become the same as the Conservative Party. So I wanted to escape from that, and I also wanted to escape from the professionalization of the novelist as being the main carrier of a genre that was supposed to embody this new globalized world. And the novelist's duty was to identify himself as this carrier and identify himself basically by producing novels. So you had to produce a novel every 2 years to remind people of the fact that you were a novelist. The fact that you were a novelist didn't have anything to do with your writing. It had to do with, was it Paul de Man who said about, the cow producing milk identifies the fact that it's a cow. So the novelist producing novels. The moment where you stepped out of this, I'm writing an essay, I'm writing a poem, I'm doing music, caused panic among novelists, as if a cow had suddenly said, it wants to write. How can this be a cow? So I began at that time to write short stories. I published a book of short stories called Real Time. I published a book of poetry. I published Clearing a Space, my first book of critical essays, that I've been writing over, and Francis Robinson, who edited that series, is sitting here. And two anthologies, as you said. These were all things I wanted to do. I thought to myself, why does being a writer have to be equal to being a novelist? That is, why must I think that everything that I find of interest and of urgency, why do I need to address this in this one genre? Other genres are of great interest to me, and I want to explore them. And so these 9 years was a kind of detoxification from the novel, which I will rename as deprofessionalization. I began to deprofessionalize myself and open myself out. I began my music project called This Is Not Fusion at that time as well. You know, say what I sang yesterday was Hindustani classical music, but I began a project called This Is Not Fusion, and that was in 2004 to 2005. So it was a great period for me, not such a good period for the publishers as far as I was concerned, because yes. And there was an edit in the Guardian very nice to have that, called In Praise of Amit Chaudhuri. They used to have a series in which they said he must be a nightmare to his publishers. So that was that period.
Okay, so I wanted to, there were two kind of interlinked things. You know, you grew up in a family where you learned your love of music from your mother. I wonder, did you ever sort of consider, was there a choice that you had to make between music and literature when you set out to become a writer? And is there a link in your mind between music and literature in your writing? I mean, I notice it in your language, but I mean, is this something conscious in you?
There's no conscious link. I mean, excuse me. there are commonalities. There are several people who inhabit my inhabit me under this rubric of my name, there is no overt connection between them, that the one doesn't necessarily know what the other is doing. So when I'm singing, I'm not kind of aware that I write novels. When I was performing yesterday, I had no kind of memory of being a novelist. But there are commonalities between these personalities. But the musician in me, and the composer, and the writer, all these sides of me like sound. Noise, background noise, except that. I like my consciousness being interrupted by sound, as a composer. So many of my compositions are about sound often. Soundscapes of any kind in the world interest me, as a writer too. So I write often about sound, what things are.
Yes.
Sounding like in the distance.
Yes.
So say in a soundtrack in a film,
yes.
The great filmmakers,
yes.
Of a certain period, like Jean Renoir,
mm-hmm.
or Satyajit Ray, who learned a lot from Jean Renoir. What is interest to me is the action within the frame and the invisible action indicated or impinging upon the action in the frame, but with no relevance to it, suggested by the soundtrack. So
mm-hmm.
I think Renoir first captures this soundtrack to do with India, that you know, one is always distracted,
yes.
By the invisible, because
mm-hmm.
sound indicates something that is not visible to you. So you have within this medium, which has to do with the visible, you have the visible action in the frame. And then from moment to moment, you have this impact of the invisible. And Jean Renoir constantly captures that through, in a film called The River, which is informed by the invisible, the soundtrack, telling us that something else, which has no relevance to this, is happening somewhere else. And Ray continues this project. Ray's soundtracks are remarkable, not just for the music, but for incidental sound, revealing to us at every moment the presence of what is not visible. I'm deeply interested in that, both as a musician and as a writer. Otherwise, there's a degree of fitfulness about how I became anything. I never thought I would write novels. I never thought I would be singing Hindustani classical music. I turned to it at the age of 16.
Uh-huh.
Before that, I used to play the guitar. When I was uh-huh. very small, I wanted to be a general in the army. I wanted uh-huh. to be a chauffeur. That was my first kind of ambition. So, you know, I mean, but so there's this general kind of fitfulness. I never thought I'd pick up the guitar again. Once I began doing Indian classical music, because I'd completely disavowed my early teenage years listening to and playing the guitar and listening to Western music. But then I went back to it. So, again, I mean, I think the other characteristic that these sides share is a kind of degree of unpredictability, fitfulness. Yeah.
The other thing which you mentioned earlier is you were talking about your critical work and the different works you did. We talked about this earlier. A lot of writers, sort of a novelist, and so on, they're very disparaging about critics, and they don't want to have anything to do with them. But you write critical work. What is the relationship between critical work and your creative work? And your collection, A Clearing a Space, won the Infosys Prize, as described as the best work of criticism by an Indian in Caravan magazine. You've written critical works on D.H. Lawrence and Tagore. Your book on Tagore is actually an essay collection arguing a reassessment of his work. Can you comment on all these things and link it up? Is there a link between your
I think there's a link. I think there's a link in the sense that the critical... Well, one of the reasons I undertook the critical work is, I suppose, to make my affiliations with modernism and this fact that modernism was situated in India within the avant-garde traditions was situated and cosmopolitanism was situated in the Indian languages that the Indian languages were not to be identified with an immemorial tradition. We had to go to the Indian languages in order to access the avant-garde. So I, who found myself a misfit in the more global or national narrative driven sort of novel, rushed the onwards, but found myself interested in European and in Anglophone modernists, but then also found myself interested in Bengali writers for this very reason, not because they were somehow more authentic, but because they were engaged in this experiment to do with language and the senses and living in the world, unburdened by national identity. Firstly, I had to make sense of this and my own affinities in a time when I should have been on that particular bandwagon or whatever you want to call it.
Yes.
I would have been, as I've said many times, very happy to have been on the bandwagon. Mm-hmm. I mean, I always want to be on a bandwagon but find that, you know, I don't fit in, and then I'm in this unhappy position where I have to figure out critically why I cannot get onto the bandwagon. So this was one of the reasons why I began to write criticism. But at the same time, I was rejecting academic criticism. So I was rejecting the neutral tone, the footnoted scholarly piece, and more than anything else, the neutral tone of scholarship. Mm-hmm. I wanted to write about the man who had woken up and had a cup of coffee and then gone out for a walk and then had begun thinking about certain things, maybe to do with form or whatever. And that journey is part of a thought process. And that is common with the novel, that the novel also examines this relationship with the self and with life. So for me, there is no the demarcation between critical writing and the creative process is blurred, and I think I'm interested in writers who blurred this process. I'm interested in someone like, say, Eliot, for instance, and the way he talks about creativity. He's responding to Matthew Arnold and to Philip Sidney, and he says it's not just the heart which produces poetry, because Sidney says, look into thy heart and write. Mm. He says, not just the heart, but the cerebral cortex and the spleen and the liver and the spinal cord, etc. And D.H. Lawrence says something similar about thought, that thought is not just about the brain. It's about his phrase is, the man in his wholeness, wholly attending. It's the body. It's all of us. And so I am interested in the way that what we call thought and what we call poetry are related in that sense, that they come come from all of us, and they come from this this encounter with life. That is, the man who wakes up and has coffee is also the person who is engaged in a thought process. So in that sense, yes, I've been trying to explore that space. Clearing a space is full of those, is almost entirely made up of that kind of essay. You know, the person who is eating or drinking is also the person who's thinking. Not drinking too much, but you know, drinking is the important.
I think we're actually quite, because I want to open it up to the floor, I think we're running out of time a bit. Yeah. So I'm going to ask you about, you've been giving creative writing, 6-week creative writing courses.
No, just 2 8-day creative writing courses.
Very intense. In Calcutta. This is part of the University Visa Program.
Right.
And they were open actually to all South Asians, weren't they?
They're open to everybody in the world.
Can you tell us about that very quickly? And then I'd like you to
Creative writing courses I look upon with suspicion, because I myself am not a product of one. But I've seen that they actually attract wonderful people, and then they also, even within 8 days, that there's a metamorphosis of a certain kind. And I began to do this as an experiment at the request of the University of East Anglia, an international creative writing workshop, that is, people from anywhere can apply in Calcutta. This year, I'm not sure whether one is happening or not, but they've been happening since 2013, twice a year. And I do those along with a distinguished co-tutor. And the other thing I do is I host a yearly discussion, and this has been happening from late 2014 onwards, on what I call literary activism, which is a way of rethinking what literature or the literary means to us today.
That's in Calcutta.
That's in Calcutta, in Delhi. It's happened in Oxford as well, and it's going to happen this month in Delhi.
Well, I think could you just
this month's theme is against storytelling. The next symposium.
So actually, if you can get a visa, it'd be very nice to attend one of his creative writing courses, I think.
Yeah, and the symposium.
And if you could just read a short piece from your book.
Yeah.
And then we'll open it out for questions.
I'm going to read out two or three pages from this third section in the book, where Amit Chaudhuri and his wife and daughter come back to Bombay, but not for a literary visit. It's not connected to a literary festival or a book reading of any kind. They just want a holiday. The only person who knows about them being there is Ramu, the friend of Amit's youth, who has returned and is now back in Bombay, who's returned from rehab, is in Bombay. And I'm reading this section out because this is perhaps the most self-reflexive part of the book, where I talk about some of the things I've been talking about with Muneeza. About the writing of the book. I see Bombay sooner than I'd expected, and Ramu. The reason is banal. Barely a month's passed. My daughter's annual exams are done. My wife has one of her bouts of intense longing. She's keen to leave everything, everything being Calcutta. Jaisalmer, she says. For 2 decades, she's wanted to introduce me to Rajasthan, the forts, palaces, shrines, the brown horizons. But I'm resistant to history. I suppose I become uncooperative. Are you mad? Do you know how hot it will be? I have no interest in the peacocks. It turns out our daughter would tolerate going to Bombay, with its shops, cinemas, and cafes. Bombay, history's very antithesis. And clearly you don't need an excuse, says my wife. She's at once resigned and invigorated. There's the prospect of much window shopping. Tell you what, I reply. Let's stay at the Taj, the old wing, I'll grovel and wheedle a special rate. She stares at me. I don't splurge on hotels. They're taken care of by publishers and festivals. Holidays are combined with readings, a discounted package. And I've never stayed in the old wing. There was never a reason or opportunity. I plead for a reduction. I do my best to impress the manager. You know, I wrote about the Taj for the Guardian the day after 26 November. I see, sir, he says with the requisite gravity. I go on, now shameless. Actually, a bit of my fifth novel describes the Taj. Out of a sense of decency, he gives me a near affordable rate for a sea-facing room. The outing remains a secret. I don't tell my daughter. I want to surprise her. My mother-in-law breaks it to her when they're together. I hear you'll be at the Taj. My daughter forgets to mention this, so we don't know that she knows till I tell her later. I hardly tell anyone in Bombay except Ramu. I don't want Janardhan to take over the visit. This is pure holiday. My wife and I resolve not to tell the wider world because it might be best that people don't know that we are staying in a fancy place. It's sure to be held against us. By now, I'm well into a book. It's about Bombay. I've been writing it for a year. I tell my wife, it isn't a holiday for me, it's a research trip. It's a well-known fact that no novel is taken seriously in India until a good deal of research has gone into it. This stay in the Taj will be my research. Going down the stairs will be research, so it'll be looking out at the sea. In the meantime, because I'm writing, I'm thinking of Bombay. I think of Ramu. The Ramu I know and the Ramu I'm writing about have become indistinguishable. The same's true of the Bombay I'm recounting from experience and the Bombay I'm assembling through words. This is often how novels begin for me. There's a convergence. I live. Then something prompts me to write. The writing is not about life. It is a form of living. The two happen simultaneously. I love the title Friend of My Youth from an Alice Munro story. I haven't read the story. That's because the title must have implied a possibility. When that happens, when the title or first paragraph contains a promise, I become spellbound and keep returning to it. The work becomes irrelevant. The writer in me takes over from the reader, and my inchoate premonition of what the story will be dominates the story itself. I've hoarded titles and paragraphs for this reason, but never followed through. Naturally, when I first fell in love with Alice Munro's title, I had no idea that I'd one day want to write about Ramu and Bombay. Ramu was still to vanish. The experience of feeling unexpectedly bereft was to come. So were the attacks of 26 November. As these and other events happened, it's as if the title knew it had to meet them halfway, sensed it, and they had been traveling towards each other. The book is a novel. I'm pretty sure of that. What marks out a novel is this. The author and the narrator are not one, even if, by coincidence, they share the same name. The narrator's views, thoughts, observations, essentially the narrator's life, are his or her own. The narrator might be created by the author, but is a mystery to him. The provenance of his or her remarks and actions is never plain.
Thank you so much. That's a lovely way to end the talk, because it sums up, I think. Are there any questions?
Well, it's just a comment. you're very lucky that there isn't a copyright on titles. So, but I just thought, I mean, this is really taking...
Eliot was very lucky that there was no copyright on all the things he borrowed from. I mean, we are all lucky. Yes, we all rework.
Obviously, yeah. I mean, the Odyssey, for example, whatever.
Yeah.
That's
James Joyce, lucky as again.
Intertextuality. Yeah. Yeah. But this thing of actually taking the actual title, I think, is wonderful.
Thank
but
you.
Has she written to you or anything? Or have you written
to
her?
You know, I know her because I was... part of a jury which gave her the Man Booker International Prize. I should have written to her for a blurb saying that, you know, I gave you a prize, now I've used your title. No, I haven't been in touch with her.
Any more? There's one here, yes?
Hi, Amit. I find it interesting you're talking about how having that single protagonist and then sort of building that, imagining a context or a world behind them, you find that to be almost oppressive, you said, mm-hmm. as an approach. And yet there is the need for a writer to sort of hold the story together as well. How do you balance between the two? How do you bring in structure without allowing yourself or your character to be, you know, oppressed by it?
Yeah. I don't know. Yes, structure and craft are very important to me. But they also, the craft and intuition also have to do with keeping things out, with not saying. The moment you are making those decisions, you're making decisions to spread out things, to making decisions towards walking that journey, which is going off in different directions, and to go off in different directions, you are unshackling, but you are also the work takes shape by what you have not said, what you have kept out. The primary unit to me is not the sentence. The primary unit to me is not the story. It's the paragraph. It's the paragraph. So even as a reader, I used to read poetry much more than I did fiction. I began to discover the fiction that would mean something to me by encountering it in the form of a paragraph quoted by a critic, let's say. So one of the first such paragraphs was from A House for Mr. Biswas by V.S. Naipaul, where Mr. Biswas's life as a sign painter is being described. So he's been a bus conductor, and then he moves on to becoming a sign painter. Then he's painting these signs in the English language, and he's thinking about the letters he loves most. And the letters, he can't decide between S and R. Both seem to possess a great grace and capacity for movement. I remember encountering this paragraph and reading it again and again. The thing about this paragraph was its sense of possibility. And I've said this in relation to something I wrote about this book. Opening paragraphs always absorb me because they have a sense of possibility that the story closes down. When I read that paragraph by Naipaul, it almost seemed a shame to me that I would have to read the novel.
That's really interesting, yes.
Then the question is, how does one keep producing paragraphs which are new beginnings rather than a sequence of information? That is always what I've been interested in. How to make every paragraph an opening out rather than a closing down in compliance with narrative. And then to create an illusion of sequentiality, which is what A Strange and Sublime was, Sublime Address was. You know, the people, I've written in this essay, one American, young American reader who came to me for advice on creative writing at a time when I was at Oxford as creative arts fellow but doing nothing had nothing to do with creative writing at all, but he had noticed this appellation and come to me. He said to me, he made a very acute comment. He said, he liked Estrangers, he read Estrangers from Amateurs, he liked it a lot, and he said that, but it's true, right, that the paragraph that follows the previous paragraph could just do just as well before that previous paragraph. You know, the sequence is an illusion. I said, you're completely right. In fact, many of these paragraphs have been just sequentially arranged in a particular way, but they're actually each one of them opening paragraphs. That illusion of sequentiality I did away with in Afternoon Rag, where the progression is far more openly collage-like or montage-like and disjunctive. But that's always the case. And so this is one of the reasons that this is happening is because of my unwillingness to attach myself to an unfolding story about something, some central event or character or happening. One is trying to open things out. The paragraphs are an opening onto this irresolution of life. That's what I'm interested in. Okay. I probably haven't answered your question.
Well, that's a really fascinating insight, I think, into your work and to your approach to it. Any more questions?
I think, in fact, I think, I suppose it's your own discourse, right? Like writing, living in writing rather, telling their story. But living in writing doesn't leave the writer in fantasy.
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch that.
Have you got me?
Can you just kind of
okay. I think
just say that again.
In fact, living in writing doesn't leave the writer in
always
fantasy.
Fantasizing.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that's what, I think so.
That's what, and that fantasy doesn't drag the writer or the story away from the facts or figures like this.
The role of fantasy is important. You know, I mean. Nowadays, of course, fantasy has a very narrow commercial definition. It means, people flying about on a broomstick and dragons and nuclear weapons all on the same terrain. So it's a genre. Fantasy for me is daydreaming. So I'm talking about daydreaming over here. Reading a paragraph, being transfixed by it, and constructing a novel around it in one's head. Looking at a title, being transfixed by it, allowing the reader to become the writer, in a sense, all these are related to the daydream, which is a word I prefer to fantasy, but it is related to fantasy in the old sense that we are fantasizing about something. That's very important to a writer. So if the writer is in a, no, nobody unfortunately can be in a constant state of daydreaming and shouldn't be. It's bad for them. But writers are flirting with what's bad for them all the time. Writing itself is a form of addiction because of what it does to time. Time does not behave normally in a work of the imagination. And the fact that we return to it again and again, to this abnormal sense of time, signifies an addiction. So it's bad for you. It's not good for your health, but it also it renews your perception of life. So I suppose one has to not completely let go of facts and figures, but there is this. Daydreaming is integral to creativity.
Thank you. I think we are out of time. Have we got? Have we got time for a question more?
Well, I was just wondering, where is home now? Are you one of, like Rushdie said, the deracinated writer? That is his donne. I mean, when I read your books,
yeah.
I have echoes of Ray, the Middleman, or Chorangi Road, or, Bharati Mukherjee. But is that the world you mind, Bombay and Calcutta? Have you written about, I know you've referred to England in one or two occasions, but where do you see yourself? Is it where your children are going to school or what? Where is home?
On one level, it's where my family is, yeah. My immediate family, yeah. Definitely.
Yes.
On another level, it's somewhere I return to at night. I've written about this in this book, but yes. it's one finds that when one is in a foreign city, one says, you have to get back to your hotel at night, and he says, I have to go back home. To go back home now. So home is that place you get back to at night. But there's a confusion in me about elsewhere and home, because I'm deeply drawn to wanting to inhabit those places that feel like elsewhere, and those that seems like home to me. I think there are a lot of people who writers used to hang out in cafes. That's because cafes, although that might be a cafe in your own city, always has the feel of being in a different city, so there's that confusion as well. Yeah.
Well, I think home is a good point to end. Thank you so much, Amit. It's been a great pleasure, and thank you all for being such a terrific audience.
Thank you so much.